Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Please, Mr. Sutton, would you have our invocation, please?
If we could have a moment, please take a moment. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day locally, but help us to realize that while the skies may be blue and the weather may be good here and elsewhere, that there is much strife in our world. Please be with the people in Haiti, the survivors, the rescue people. Please help us realize that it's not for us to ask why, but to ask for forgiveness and ask for direction for the future. As you remind us in Isaiah, that the heavens are bigger and higher than the earth. Be with us as we go forward and help us always to find the silver lining, and no matter what the tragedies in life are, personal or nationally. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to have the public comments, but I do want to say we can't use the overflow room tonight, so if you get through with whatever you want to talk about and you don't have any other thing to talk about, we would, if you would, just step out, and so, because we got a really big agenda tonight. And please limit your comments to 3 minutes. And at this time, I will open the public comments for Pam Horn. Is this right? Horn, sorry. Look like a D. If you'll come up here, please.
Yes.
I'm sorry. It looked like a D on here.
I'm here about the high impact land ordinance for this racetrack on Jughouse Road. I live on Jughouse Road, and I've been there for 25 years. And I just feel like that if they're allowed to do this, they've had a track down there about 10, 12 years ago. The noise was horrible. The dust, people drinking, throwing litter out on the roads. It'll depreciate my land value, I know. And I was wondering about the restroom facilities, what they would do about that, possible fuel spills from all this. And I just feel like, you know, it's an invasion of my privacy. I won't even be able to use my own backyard on weekends because of the noise from a go-kart track, and it's just, I hope you'll consider, you know, not giving me permit to open it up, because no one deserves a go-kart track in the front door. Now, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Horn. Kim Oliver?
Sure.
Hey, how are
you? Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening, Kim.
I want to take a moment tonight to follow up on a request I made some time back regarding the repairs and renovation projects approved last year. During the commissioners' meeting that night in which the budget was approved for that work, I stood before you with concerns over our local economy and asked that you make every effort to use local contractors. I also asked the board to ensure that no illegal immigrant labor be used on those projects and state need verify into those contracts. Can you now please confirm that those requests were honored as you agreed to in that meeting? I've been unable to find not one local contractor in this county that benefited from any of those projects. And with local unemployment rates in double digits, I worry that not enough is being done. You know, the citizens in this county want work, not welfare and unemployment. Who do I need to go to that can provide me the information on how the contracts were awarded and who was doing the work?
Mr. Burgess would be who you'd have to go through. Is that not
Mr. correct? Honeycutt.
Yeah.
Our assistant county manager is not here at this time. He is out of the country. With respect to your question, was it a requirement for contractors and such to be e-verified?
I addressed commissioners that night.
You did?
Yes,
and
yes,
I remember
sir.
That.
As well as quite a few other people.
In all honesty, there was not any requirement within those contracts that required e-verification. We were not using federal funds. We it slipped through the cracks and that did not occur.
Well, I just think, you know, personally, as a taxpaying paying citizen of this county, I think it's the right thing to do.
And we agree with you, and that was a mistake we made. One thing we have asked from our architect is to get a ask our subs and our contractors that they would be willing to voluntarily do E-Verify for us and make sure that we're not hiring illegal immigrants to work on county properties and county facilities. So we have asked that question, and hopefully we will get a response back. We asked that last Thursday, so we are working on that. But also with the new projects that we're going to do in the 6.5, their requirements under the Federal Stimulus Act and the Davis-Bacon laws that requires that all subs and all contractors E-Verify. It slid through the cracks with respect to the first round. It will not slide through the cracks with respect to the second round.
And Kim, if I can address Kim, if that's okay.
Sure.
I know that they have been working with the local Home Builder Association and getting bids out, because I get them on email every so often, where they come from the county, where Tim has worked out with Susan over there, and maybe that's something if you're interested in, you may want to get it too. But one of the real problems we've had over this is our local people hadn't come in the best price. And right. We do have to
I understand that, but you know, the lowest bid's not always the way to go. Especially when the money can stay right here in this county. It is, after all, it's taxpayer money.
Kim, I agree with you 100%. Yeah. I'd love to see us be able to award everything locally, but that there are some stipulations, because I've been with Craig about that and Tim both. And
one thing we have done is we've met with the Chamber, we've met with the Home Builders Association. We have it on our website as far as when projects are due and the bidding requirements, those type of things. We have sent out letters. We have really done everything that we've known to do locally, you know, internally, to get the word out to our contractors that live in the county. So we really have tried that. We did let the other thing slip, and it was not a requirement in the contracts. Again, we're trying to go back and trying to rectify that and see if they're willing to state that now. But on the second round, it is a federal requirement they'll have to do anyway.
They have used due diligence in trying to get the local contractors to submit bids, because I have checked behind it. And either they're coming way above the low bid, or no bid's coming in at all from Alamance County.
And part of that is the insurance and requirements.
As an employer in this county, a business owner, you know, I can't work my employees and pay them what I pay them and compete with people that's using illegal labor.
I agree.
They're going to be the low bid, of course.
I didn't know Kim was going to be here tonight. I didn't know he was going to comment about E-Verify, but you know, you and I had talked about it.
Yes, sir.
And I was going to bring it up at the end of the meeting. But what happened, I got a phone call over the weekend about some workers that they saw working for the county on a project, and asked me, were we using E-Verify? And I said, I don't know. We'll find out. And I was told that we weren't. Didn't we draw up some rules? It might have been before Craig came on board, but that we were going to use E-Verify for anything, any work done for the county. I'm sure we drew it up, because I remember seeing it.
I don't recall.
Just don't
it up.
Maybe we're talking about it.
We drew it up, or we said we were going to do it. And you know, I went over to the DMV in Greensboro. I'm over there all the time, and they have a sign on their front of their counter that says we used E-Verify. So then today, before the meeting, I went over to the DMV here, and I didn't see that same sign. So I asked a person there. I said, well, I saw the sign in Greensboro. Why don't you have it here? In a nice way. I was trying to figure out what it was. And she said, well, I believe that's the sign we have in the break room. So we went in the break room, and there's a sign from the state that says we use E-Verify for everybody they hire. And I'm almost positive that we approved that we would use E-Verify for every piece of work done for the county. Contractors, subcontractors, and at least that was the best of my memory.
We should have made that part of our standard terms and conditions for bids.
Well, now, of all the contracts that we've got coming up, how much have we got coming up?
6.5 million.
Yeah, I mean, I would hope that we could have E-Verify
make it part of
part of the contract through and through. from top to bottom, contractors, subcontractors, the whole nine yards.
And that is required under the Davis-Bacon Act in using federal stimulus bonds. Mm-hmm. So that will be a requirement that is known up front. Again, on the Group A projects, we slip right. through the
Well,
track.
You know, using federal money or local money, it still should be the right thing to do.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you for your time, Commissioner.
Thank you.
Craig Nicholson.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name's Greg Nicholson. I live on Mebane Oaks Road, south of Hebron Church in Mebane. And I was wanting to comment on the county line that's going on. I've got a paper here that I got 30 signatures on. It's for the 2008 survey that they done that goes with the original on the thing. I got out over in the central part of Orange County, and most of these people's signatures you'll see is from, say, like Highway 86 and going up from Hillsboro up toward Danville to the east of there. And I, most of them don't get the Burlington paper. They get to Durham, so they didn't know anything was going on over here on the western side. And what they all signed to go with, like I say, the original line, I know that hadn't been, you know, done, but I just was trying to get some signatures.
Okay.
You know, to, so
you want
that,
to present that?
Yeah, I want to
okay.
give it to y'all.
Okay, and I will get...
We appreciate
can
that.
We get copies
we
made for the commissioners
on
this?
Well, I could get a whole lot more. I mean, nobody knew what was going on. I took articles in the Mebane Enterprise and the Burlington paper and asked them if they knew anything was going on. And they said, no, we don't know what you're talking about, because most of them, like I say, from, say, Eflin to the east, get yeah. Durham paper yeah. instead of the Burlington paper. And I told them that, you know, it would that had already been run. 2008 survey, according to the meetings that I've come to, and it didn't have any cost to anybody. If they're going to have to resurvey, it's going to be a cost to the taxpayers, is what I've heard at the meetings I've been to and stuff. So that's for the original.
And if you will call Mr. Honeycutt, he can enlighten you more on that. Actually, he's going to talk about that tonight.
Yeah, that's one reason
okay.
I came.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Mr. Childers.
I didn't plan for me to follow Mr. Nicholson here, but it just came out that way. But I'm going to speak on the county line, obviously, I guess. But I stand where I've always stood on this, and that is basically one of fairness and non-preferential treatment along this line. And if you're going to apply a rule, then apply it to everybody along this line. That's the only way to do it. And right now what's been happening with these options coming out from Orange County, and make no mistake, this has been Orange County's agenda and Orange County's options. They were the ones that came out with these two options. They did not consult with Alamance County staff before they did this. In fact, the public meeting that Orange County called on these two options, I think Alamance staff only found out about it a day or two ahead of time. They were not consulted on it. This has been Orange County's agenda on this. And at this point, Orange County is ridiculous to the point of obstructionism on this issue. And I really don't understand what's going on. But again, I stress that if you're going to apply a rule, then apply it to everybody along the county. And picking people out in these preference groups or a developer out on this preference group, I just don't know how commissioners who really, I think, know that they represent everyone in the county can uphold with that. I just don't understand, you know, why this is – this. I don't understand why this is going on this long. And – the angst that everyone here is feeling on this line, believe me, this is because past commissioners in both counties have passed this issue on to this body of commissioners. They should have done this. 10 years ago, they could have done this. And they passed it on because they just didn't want to make the hard decision. And so it's to this body. This body needs to make a decision on this. And quite frankly, legally, the way that I've looked at this, I don't know if county attorney can verify this or not, but Alamance County, with the legal, the laws that are written, Alamance County, because the original line was found, because the original line was verified, this county does not need Orange County's approval to go ahead and list property, which they are required to do by state law. I mean, in the North Carolina Constitution, it states that the General Assembly confers upon each county the power to levy within the limitations set taxes on property having a situs within the county. You can go to time for listing properties. Place the county is on a time frame here for getting this done, quite frankly. I mean, the listing period, unless extended as provided in this section, which is an extra 60 days, I believe, you must list all property located within the county by the end of January. So, I mean, both counties are contravening state law. They're contravening the Constitution of North Carolina. And I know that the commissioners have supported the sheriff in the application of the letter of the law for illegal immigrants here. And now the counties are kind of throwing the law to the winds. This needs to be settled, and this needs to be settled soon. And I just can't emphasize how important this is to get this over with and get on with, you know, other issues in this county. So I appreciate the time. Thank you.
Christopher Vaughn.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm also here to talk on the Orange-Alamance County line. I brought with me a revised petition with additional signatures on it from the one I presented, I believe it was November. And of the signatories on this petition, six are from Mill Creek itself. One is from Alamance County, who owns land on 10th Street in Orange County. And the remainder are Orange County residents, to my knowledge.
Do they have an address as to where they live?
The vast majority of them do.
This is Mabin or Eflin. They don't. There's a few that's got their address on Oberlin. I know Oberlin is, too. That's not in Mill Creek.
And if you'd like that information, I can
that'd be good.
Yeah.
All right. We'll get copies of that, maybe.
What I would like to reiterate, and Mr. Childers and Nicholson also covered, was I'd like for you to please consider strongly the option to keep the 1849 line and preserve my property owner rights.
Thank you, Mr. Vaughn. Okay, that concludes the public comments tonight. So we will close the public comments at this time, and we will hear from Becky Loy with Cobbsey Loy and Company.
Good evening. I am here tonight to talk to you about your audit for the year ended June 30, 2009. You have in front of you a copy of your financial statement. The large one is your full financial statement. But I'm going to go over the small statement, which is has hopefully I've been able to graph a few key items so that you can see in a snapshot where the county has ended up financially for the year. If you turn to the first graph, I'll just start with the general fund. The general fund, of course, is your large operating fund, and as you can see, we're pretty consistent in that we are still at that top level, but we did have a decline in the revenue. Your revenue this year is $124.5 million. Last year, $126.3 million. So your revenue's gone down. Your revenue has gone down pretty significantly, $1.8 million. If I look at the purple line, the purple is your expenditures. $127.5 million compared to $124.3 million last year. Expenses went up, revenue went down. So you kind of got hit by both sides on your general fund. Your general fund, of course, is your main fund. That's where most of your money goes in. And so that's where we really judge the financial stability of the county. So if I look at the revenue and try to figure out what actually changed, it really kind of keys in on one thing, your local option sales tax. It declined compared to last year, $4.7 million. And when I go through all of these numbers, it's going to be the same answer, your local option sales tax. That is really what has impacted the revenue and the expenditures, the total, once you take the expenditures away, that's what's really impacted your bottom line.
Was that due to the Medicaid switch out, or forgive me for interrupting?
State taking part of it.
It's the state taking part of it, and it's just the economy.
Okay.
A lot of that is just from the economy.
Yeah, as portion I've, of it is the Medicaid, though.
I don't know.
Tell.
Yeah. I do not have the breakdown of that. But as I've gone through these meetings, it's been consistent. We've seen a lot of municipalities, a lot of governments that have had this kind of decrease in their sales tax. But I don't have that breakdown. I apologize.
So this car is sales would have a lot to do with it.
So this is coming.
I think
at this point in time,
it is. Yes, it is. The impact for you, of course, is a lot larger because you're a larger entity. The one thing that I think will make a difference, of course, the economy once it picks up. That will make a difference, but you also have Tanger coming in, and so the sales tax from that will make a difference. So hopefully we will see some recovery in that. Unfortunately, at one point in time, I thought it would be we get down to the bottom and then we're going to rise back up, not as fast, but unfortunately, I think we're going to sit at the bottom a little while. I had a lot of people say we're there. Some people say we're not there. I tend to believe that we are there, but I think it's going to be very, very slow in that recovery. So I don't think you're going to jump up in the next 2 years. I think it's going to be a little longer than that. The result of this is that for your general fund, you had a $3 million excess of expenditure over your revenue, which means that you spent more than you brought in, which means that you used some of your fund balance. Using your fund balance is not a terrible thing. It's there. You've put it back. You've built it up so that when you needed it, it was there. The problem with using fund balance is that it is not a long-term solution. You cannot continue to use your fund balance. It will go away very quickly at $3 million a year. And so as a board, I caution you in going forward, because I do think it's going to be slow. You're going to have to really look at the expenditures. And I'm telling all the people that I deal with, nonprofits, governmental, spend what you get in, because that's break even, and that's where you might not be building, but you're not using either. There were some things that you didn't have come through, some timing things that impacted this. You had $500,000 that went out for some renovations that you'll get that money back. And so there are some things like that, but we still know that there was a $4.7 million drop in sales tax. And so you've still got an issue here. And I'm afraid it's going to be very slow, as I said, in the recovery. And so if I look at your revenue and try to figure out, other than the sales tax, the other things where you saw decreases were permits and fees, things that are driven by the economy, those you did see a decrease in. But the second item is your interest. The interest went down significantly. Your interest 2 years ago was $2.7 million. Last year, $1.6 million. This year, $814,000. And it's not because you have less cash. It's because you're not earning anything on that interest. And as you go through and try to find places to put it, there is nothing that's paying a good rate. CDs are not paying. Mutual funds, money market funds are not paying. It's not there. Being able to move the money and get a higher rate is just really not an option that's out there. And so, again, that's an impact from the economy, the state of the economy. And I'd like to say that it's going to recover and we'll see that change, but it's going to be slow. And so those two pieces alone really made a significant difference in where you ended up this year. If I look at the value of your property in Alamance County, went up 2%. Your taxes did go up a little bit, $1.4 million increase in your taxes, but that's because of the valuation. It went up a little bit, so you generated a little more in taxes. I think that's just the time delay of adding. You know, we were in a big period of growth, and it takes a little bit of time for that growth to get in there. And so really the value hasn't been impacted by the economy at this point. So we'll see where that goes. And, of course, you had the revaluation and all that's gone on with that. So we'll see where that ends up. On your valuation, 1 cent of your tax rate is about $1 million. That's just for information for you. So as you can see, we look at your general fund, which is your main operating fund, $3 million loss, pretty significant. So as you go forward, if you look at the bottom is your excess. And as you can see, there have been other years where there was a loss in the general fund. But you can see the years that a lot was added to the general fund as well. And so you're going to have those ups and downs. This year just happens to be one of the years that's not so good. If you look at the second graph on page 2, that's your landfill. Your landfill fund is full accrual. And so that it is accounted for a little bit differently than the general fund. Everything that is due to the landfill is recorded. Everything the landfill owes out is recorded. And so your closure and post-closure liabilities are included in the numbers that you have before you. The revenue for the landfill was $3.6 million. Last year, $3.6 million, a very small decrease in the revenue. The expenditures did go up. And that increase in expenditures is due to an increase in the post-closure cost. There was also another item that had to be added this year that was state mandated in the post-closure cost that had to be added. So both of those actually impacted the difference, and that's pretty much all the difference in the expenditures for this year. Even with that increase in the post-closure cost, you still had $1 million excess in your landfill fund. So that's still a very strong fund. The cash, if you look at your financial statements, you'll go in and look at the balance sheet and you'll have almost $12 million in cash, which when you got $1 million added, you got to kind of have some other pieces there to make sense of that. When you look at that cash, it's almost $12 million, but you have liability of almost $8 million, and that's the closure and post-closure. So you've got to remember when you're looking at the landfill, you've got a big liability that kind of sits out there that has to be put aside for the closure cost. If you look at the graph on page 3 and 4 are your employee insurance fund and your workman's comp fund, and you might at this point wonder why these graphs are even in here still. But if you go back to the beginning of these graphs and look at 2001, you'll see that you had $1.4 million loss in that fund. And then if you keep going, you see losses there that were pretty continuous. Your fund balance was pretty low at that time. It was under $1 million up until 2005, and so the fund was struggling, and so that's why we added these graphs at that time, and I left them in there because you have been able to address this problem, and so I wanted you to see where you kind of started from and where you are now. The revenue was $7.8 million. Last year was $8.6 million, so there's been a decrease in the revenue. The expenditures were $6.3 million. Last year, $6.7 million. So you've seen a decrease in the expenditures. Now you know in this kind of fund, you have no control over the expenditures at all. And so what you have to do is build a fund balance. And that's you didn't have a fund balance, and that's why I was concerned about this fund, because for so many years you did not have a significant fund balance, and any major year of expenditures would have wiped that fund balance out. Your fund balance at this point is $7.7 million in that fund. And so you have been able to increase and add to that fund balance. From here forward, what you've got to look at is trying to break even. And so your revenue's got to match the expenditures. If it doesn't in the year, because you're guessing, you've got to make it up. You've got to look at how to make it up if you have a deficit year. And so again, the goal is to break even, but even if you can't break even in that year, it's to address it pretty quickly. What we saw going forward in the years past was that it wasn't being addressed quick enough. The recovery was too slow on that, but you have been able to recover that fund, and it's very healthy at this point. Workman's comp is the same way, $900,000. Last year you had $1 million, but that did include a reinsurance reimbursement. So revenue still very comparable. Your expenditures, $510,000, very comparable to last year. You added $422,000 to the fund balance, and your fund balance is $1.3 million. So again, that fund is pretty strong as well. And so I commend you for looking at those and dealing with them and getting them where they needed to be. Page 5 has got a lot of numbers on it, and I'm just going to highlight, but what I wanted to do was give you some information and allow you to compare it to some other counties. And so I'm going to start at the top. Your revenues were $124 million. You budgeted $130 million. You were short budget to actual on taxes by 1.3 and the local option sales tax by 2.7. Those were your two main line items where you were significantly less than what you budgeted. So you didn't bring in the revenue you budgeted for. The offset to that is that your total expenditures were $127.5 million, but you budgeted $134.7 million. I've always said that if you don't meet your revenue, as long as you're not spending everything you budget, it can work itself out and still be a good year because you didn't spend as much as you thought you were going to. And that's still true. You still didn't spend as much as you thought you were going to, but in the end, you still ended up with a deficit. And so it's good not to spend all that you've budgeted for, and that is that's managing it. That's looking at what you have to spend and managing what you need to spend, but you still ended up with that deficit. Your total fund balance is $27.5 million. And so if I look at last year, because you had that $3 million loss, you're at $27.5 million. So the middle of this chart is your fund balance. And I separated it out into four different columns, which is required by the local government commission to be reported in the financial statement. And so I just wanted to give you that information so you would know kind of what I'm talking about when I do the comparables. It's split down into reserve by state statute, which is basically your accounts receivable. Reserve for encumbrances, which is where you've committed the money to projects or expenditures. The unreserved includes designated, which is for next year's budget. It's what you think you're going to have to use out of next year's budget. And then the undesignated is what's available. So your total general total fund balance was $27.5 million. If I look at what's available, that's what the LGC, which is the local government commission, is going to look at when they look at your financial stability. You're required to have 8% of your expenditures in that total unreserved fund balance. You have to have 8%. 8% is $10.2 million, and you have $18 million. So you meet those minimum requirements. But that doesn't really tell you a whole lot. And so what I've added at the bottom is some comparables for you. For 2007-2008, I'm comparing to the latest year of data that we have, which is 2008. If I look at all the counties over 100,000, the percentage that they look at is the available fund balance over the expenditures. And that's 18.26 for all counties over 100,000 in population. Well, that includes some really big counties, and so that's not necessarily the best comparable. So I looked at the 10 closest in size. Now, that can include some counties that really might not be very comparable to you because of the dynamics and things that are involved in from one county to the other, but that's still a little better comparable than all the counties, and that's 20.52. Your percentage for 2008-2009 is 14.23. That percentage has been going down, and when you use fund balance, it's going to go down. What it looks at is your available that we've talked about and your expenditures. Your available went down, your expenditures went up, and so that makes that percentage even less. So your percentage is 14.23. That percentage really needs to be stronger, and hopefully as you go forward, you will work on having a break-even year. A year of $3 million loss of excess of expenditures over revenues, okay, but the key is not to continue to have that, and so hopefully that percentage will correct itself. So as I go on and look at comparables, the average tax rate, your tax rate is 58, and as you can see, I've looked at four counties, which I believe it was Mr. Smith and Amy and I determined which four counties were the most comparable to Alamance County in the different types of activities that go through the county, and these were the four that were most comparable. Randolph is 53.5, Davidson 54, Cabarrus 63, Pitt County 71. So as you look at those, your rate is not way different than what those rates are, so very comparable on the rates. The other information that I added at the bottom, and it's kind of thrown in there a little bit, but I wanted the comparable, what was the collection percentage. As you look at the taxes, you want to know what kind of job is being done in the collection. And so I have put on here the first column under collection percentage is the collection percentage for the other counties, the other four counties. The next section is your collection percentage. And your collection percentage this year is 97.3, which is the lowest that it has been in 10 years. And so that's not a good position, but I think given where the county has been and hopefully we're going forward, that can be looked at. I know one of the issues with that was follow-up on old accounts that needed to be, they have to be worked. They have to be, try to figure out how to get those collected. And I know that was one of the issues that was included in that, but it is the lowest rate that you've had in 10 years. The highest was 98.99, so at 2001, it got really, really high. 98 is a pretty high rate. So that's not necessarily the normal, but there is a pretty good swing there. And so if I look at and compare that to the other counties, Randolph was 99.39, Davidson 97.61, Cabarrus 99.16, and Pitt 97.61. So it's still not way under what the other counties are, but it is low for this county. So that is an issue that I know will be addressed going forward. If I look at the average collection percentage, counties statewide, 98.37. Counties over 100,000, 98.77. So that is something that does need to be looked at, and hopefully with new folks coming in, that will be able to be improved. And so those are the numbers. It's not as positive as years past. It's always easier for me to come in and talk about positive numbers, but as you go forward, the important thing is to look to break even, spend what you have coming in, because you do not want another $3 million. You're at $15 million in your fund balance available, and it just drops, and all those percentages start to really get out of line when that happens. And so I know it's a big challenge, and I know that you have done that and looked at that, but unfortunately I think it's going to be a long-term process. And so I was hoping that the recovery would be quick enough that we could take the hit and go forward, but that's not what I'm seeing. And so I understand the challenge is very difficult, but you do need to look at that and have that as close to break even as you can get that.
Anybody have any questions for Ms. Wolf?
I do have a couple other things to go over. That's everything on the numbers.
Oh, okay, good.
It's a lot of numbers. I always challenge the folks I talk to look at the financial statement. It's very large, and there is a lot of information in there, but there's a lot of really good information in there. And so I do, if you read that financial statement, go through there, and you'll find a lot of valuable information in that statement. The other thing that you have in your packet is the schedule of findings and question cost. You have an audit under the Single Audit Act. Because you have so much federal and state money coming through your county, you are required to have a very high-level compliance audit. And so we look at a lot of compliance and make sure that you have the procedures and that you're following the procedures that go with those grant monies. And so some of these comments are from that compliance audit. But the first one is
excuse me, what page are you on?
I'm sorry. There's a lot of verbiage there, and I'm not going to read the verbiage. That's as bad as spitting out a lot of numbers. I'm just going to summarize it for you. The first, the finding 9-1 is the first finding, and that is an overexpenditure of the budget by $8,000, which is not very much, but the Local Government Commission requires that any overexpenditure be considered a finding, because it basically means that the expenditure was not budgeted by the board. But this circumstance is a little bit different. When we're trained all the time on different things that come up, and a lot of times the training that we get is based on what is happening in the industry, in the audit world. And we had a lot of information this year about leases, and so we looked at the leases a little bit closer. And we found that there were some leases that were classified as operating that should have been capital. And what's happened is when you lease equipment, depending on some circumstances, it's either capital or it's operating, and they're treated differently depending on how they are classified. And with the economy the way it was, the leases started getting a little bit longer, and once they got a little bit longer, they no longer met the criteria for being considered operating. And so we did have to reclassify those leases as capital because they are required to be capital. And it's one of those things where one small piece of the factors that are considered changed a little bit, and it caused it to go into the capital. Amy and I have met with Frank and gone over, he'll be doing the calculations, they'll be looking at it, and they'll be making sure from now on that the leases are classified correctly. So I believe that problem will be taken care of. It's a calculation, there's 4 points on that calculation, and it's just a process to go through, and I think they have established that process. The second comment is in relation to the federal money for Medicaid, and we looked at the Medicaid eligibility manuals, and that requires that budget sheets are maintained and accurately calculated to determine eligibility. And when we looked at those files, we found a few that were not accurate and were not completed correctly. When we do the compliance, we, the state and federal government, give us a list, and they say, do this, do this, do this. That's what we do. We go in and we look at exactly what they tell us to look at. And so we don't really have discretion in what we look at. We do have to look at internal controls that the county itself has. So we look at those controls, but we also look at specific things. And eligibility is one of the areas that they really have looked at hard in the last few years, because they want to make sure that whoever's getting funding is eligible for it. And so when we did that test work, we did find a few that were not accurately completed. And so that is just an issue that needs to be, a process needs to be put in place, and the budget sheets need to be calculated accurately and in the files. 9-3, the last one, is a regarding the subsidized child care cluster. And again, it is a federal award, so we're looking at the compliance, we're looking at the specific details that we're required to look at, and one of those requirements is to update the parent fees and to make sure that the providers are paid at the correct rate. And we did find a couple of instances where the parental fee was not updated correctly and the rates were not paid out at the correct amount. When you're looking at all those numbers and you're calculating all those, there's a lot of things that you have to consider, and so these were just missed. But it is one of the specific things that we have to look at. And so, again, it's just one of those things that needs to be corrected, a procedure put in place to either have somebody sign off on them or retrain the folks that are actually doing these calculations. Unfortunately, I will tell you, Susan and Richard get very upset with me because I usually find little things, and in the scope of things, they are not major things. I just don't have the discretion of to put it in there or not. But what I'm going to tell you is that they have good controls. It doesn't look like it because I come back and have comments, but you can read these and tell that they're very nitpicky items. It's interesting, when Beth Wood was, before she was in office, she had done some trainings for CPAs, and she complained about the fact that no CPAs were writing up anybody with any kind of findings. And so what that said was that all the counties, all the municipalities getting money were perfect. Well, I look at your audit and I say, okay, we're telling you what we do wrong. We're not hiding anything. And so as a county, I think you should actually feel better having a few things there rather than having a continuously clean audit. Because those are the ones that she's going to be looking at. And she's already said she's going to be looking at them. And she's going to come out and look at some counties. Now, she hasn't done that yet. And I don't know what she'll do. But I personally think that that puts you in a little better position. Because there are some things there. And so they know we're looking at it. They know we're looking at the compliance and that someone has looked at what needs to be done. And so I want you to know that the internal controls are good. And we actually look at the specific things here, but we also do look at some of the controls that are put in by the county. We look at the prior findings and make sure that they've been resolved. And so it's a constant battle to try to make sure that you are in compliance with every little piece that is required in this kind of funding. And so even though there are some comments here, I want you to know that the Social Services has a good set of procedures, and they do try very hard to follow those.
I had actually tagged that in my book to question you on that, so thank you for that information.
You will see that there is no tax finding here. When I do a risk assessment for the county, for any municipal that we audit, for anybody that we audit, we have to look at risk assessment. And one of the things to identify risk is when issues come up. And so when you have things in the paper and there are issues that could potentially indicate a problem, we are required to look at that. And so we have gone into the tax department, looked at what's going on, questioned folks, looked at the procedures. The procedures have been changed. They've been strengthened. The procedures are good. And I did not find any indication that there was any fraudulent activity. I know everybody would like to know exactly what the solution, the issue was, what happened with the bag money. But I can't prove that. And I hope it can be proved someday, but I can't prove it. And I did not find anything in the procedures at this point. The procedures have been changed, and so, you know, once you had your other auditor come in and look at that, they made the changes, and they have been strengthened. And so I think the whole process actually probably will make things better for the county because it strengthens your processes and your procedures. And so that's not, it's not a good thing for that to happen, but that the procedures coming out of it was a good thing. And so I believe that you will have better information coming out of the tax office and better controls there. So I would have loved to have said I figured out what happened, but I did not see anything that indicated any major issues, and they did put in place the procedures that they needed to. And so that's a positive thing through this whole event. The last thing I have is just a letter, and I'm going to just go over it very quickly. You did have an unqualified opinion, which means that I did not find anything that indicated to me that the numbers that were given to me from finance were not accurate numbers. I did not find anything that was indicated that there were internal control problems or procedures that were not being followed, and so that you did have an unqualified opinion. We do audit under the OMB Circular A133, which is the compliance audit, and so you are at that highest level of audit that can be required. We do look at your accounting procedures and policies and practices. We did adopt GASB 45 this year, which is for other post-employment benefits. You would see that on your GASB 34, on your full accrual statement, which is your first two statements, you would actually see a liability for other post-employment benefits that you have not seen in the past, and that is through the implementation of this requirement. It's only in the full accrual statement, so you won't see it in what you normally deal with, which are the other statements. We also look at estimates. Anytime you have receivables and collectible percentages and things, we have to look at how those are determined. The collection amounts and any allowances that are set up, we have to look at those. And so with EMS and the landfill on the closure and post-closure, we look at how those are set up, and we're involved in the calculations of those. And so those are accurate, and we feel good about the way those estimates are being done. We did not have any difficulties. Corrected and uncorrected misstatements. We do look at the journal entries. Your books are modified accrual, which is mostly cash basis, and we do at the end of the year make it full accrual. I'm sorry, we make it modified accrual. We take your cash basis and we make it actually modified accrual. Okay, let me clarify this. You actually are cash basis. Modified accrual is where your current liabilities and current receivables are added, and so we add those. And so we take your cash basis books, what you operate with every month, and we add what is currently due, your current accounts payable, your current payroll, your current receivables. No long-term information is added. So your debt, your compensated absences, all those items are not, your fixed assets are not added on your modified accrual statements. Those are all added on the full accrual, but not on the modified accrual. And so we look at those journal entries and we make sure that what we're doing is just that conversion, that we're not correcting anything. If we're correcting a lot of things, that could be an indication of a problem with the system. And if there's a problem with the system, you can't rely on the information that's coming from the system. And we did not see anything in those journal entries that made us think we did not have good information coming through the system. We did not have any disagreements with management. They have represented to us that the information they provided us was accurate and complete. We did not become aware of any consultations with other auditors. If you have a question and you want a second opinion, go get a second opinion. But if they are required, if it is an audit related, if it's related to the audit, they are required to contact us and get information about the situation so that we can be sure they have all the information they need. We did not have any other audit findings or issues. The only other thing in this letter is just to remind you that if you're looking at the full accrual statements, you have a very unique situation in North Carolina because you take the debt of the school systems, buildings and maintenance and whatever's going on with the school system. You take the debt, but you don't take the asset. It does create a negative net asset figure for you. So if you're looking at Exhibit 1 or 2, you're going to see a negative fund balance. You're going to see a negative net assets, and that's why. And that's consistent with counties in North Carolina because you don't take the asset. The school gets the asset. And so this is, that is in the letter just to remind you of that. The last thing that you have is the memorandum that has the information for other counties. And I just put that in there so that you can access it and look at other counties, and whatever information you want to compare is available in some details. And so hopefully that will allow you to just pull out pieces of information that you would like to know for other counties. I appreciate the opportunity to do the audit. I appreciate the assistance that I get from Amy and her staff. We require a lot of information. We look at a lot of information. And, of course, we, as I said, do a lot of work at DSS and appreciate their assistance in doing that. And we appreciate the having the contract. We realize that you do get to choose who does your work for you, and we appreciate that opportunity.
Any questions?
We'd lucky to have Amy on.
Absolutely.
Susan, the rest of them. Surely are.
That's very okay. Fair of that.
Yeah. One of the counties that I'm sure we were in, that was in the mix of our comparisons, I'm sure, just one example, but they had reevaluation, and of course you don't know what stages these counties are in reevaluation. Number one, as we went from 58 to 52. You know, you alluded to 58, but one of the counties had reevaluation, and I'm sure they're in the mix, and they didn't cut their tax rate at all, and their fund balance was just out of sight. And with all due respect, in banking, when I was in banking, for the years that I was in banking, I never had a federal auditor nor a state auditor apologize for writing me up. So maybe that's the difference between government audit and private business audit. So.
I just wanted you to know what we see and what you, it looks like every year when you have comments that things aren't good. Well.
You can find it, write it up.
I actually have a little bit of reputation, I'm afraid, that I will write it up.
And good.
We feel like that it's not of value to you if we don't tell you what we find.
Nobody's perfect.
And that's what Beth Woods was saying. You know, nobody's perfect. How can these counties all be perfect? And so we want to provide value.
Good.
And the only way to do that is to tell you things that can be improved on.
Good.
We appreciate that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Becky. Okay, next we will have the... Family Abuse Services request from Mr. Parker. Hey, how are you?
Doing? This is Don Cox, of course, our vice president of our board, and we really appreciate being here today. I do want to clear up. You may have a PowerPoint in there. I don't know if you have copies of that. Good. Skip the last page. We're not coming here to request money. We probably were until Miss Lori got through, but that was a miscommunication. All right. But we really want to make you aware of some things too, that your financial problems in the community aren't great. I hear that, but some of the social problems are still out there. We want to make sure we'll give you a little statement about that. We may need to up our request in the future year. To ask for money and ask for more resources, and whether you're able to do that will depend on our economic time. We're in sort of the same shape, I think, Johnny, we'll get through. Very quickly, we'll go through this, as you are. Our fund balance ain't what it used to be, and we wish it were higher. There's the demands on us is the same as the county. It's just like any other business, and we just wanted to make sure you knew that. We appreciate everything you've done for us. We appreciate particularly being a part of the new and emerging, really incredible thing called the Family Justice Center that's emerged. It's going to be the first in the state, and I think it's incredible to be part of that leadership. Alamance County is going to be leading the way in issues of domestic violence and sexual assault pretty soon, and we're pretty well known, and then we'll be able to draw more dollars in hell. But we will give you a couple of things, I think, and we have a really great board, and appreciate John being here. A context. Yeah, I've read a couple of things I think that we need to keep in mind as we're going through this and realize we can't solve our problems is that I heard something that just blew me away, that 3.3% of our gross national product is what the cost of violence in our community is doing. That's done by the WHO organization, international organization, looking at our United States. That's 3.3% of the gross national product. And that $6 billion is spent annually on the cost of domestic violence, according to the CDC, where CDC is, but that includes mental health costs, medical costs that are associated with the problems, because people have ended up having more illness afterwards and in the long term also. So $6 billion is a lot of money. In North Carolina, I'm not sure everybody's aware, we had 131 deaths according to the North Carolina Coalition Against Domestic Violence in North Carolina alone. 131 deaths. That's some serious business and something to keep our eyes on. We haven't been immune from it. The deaths are just the top of the surface, too, because what underlies that with families and children, you know, getting long-term effects are tremendous. And I just wanted to take a moment to point out also that the Family Services may actually be providing, saving some money, as much as you give us. We think we save money. We do things that are cheaper cost than it would be for the public sector to do, and we're proud to do that. One of the benefits of having nonprofits involved is we can do things effectively, efficiently, and with less money, really. And it's not because we pay people less. It's just that we don't have as many burdens as you just heard yourself have with all that sometimes, and we feel like that's a good service. We have one of the best shelter programs in the state, and that's true. And our community education, I'm going to point out, Sheriff, our community education program is top of the line here, and our collaborations is just incredible. We collaborate with the sheriff, and one of the things we do in our collaboration is with the superintendent of schools. That's different and unique and unusual in this county, and I think we should be real proud of that. And we take a holistic look at people coming in for our agency for domestic violence, because safety assessment needs more than just helping them with a protective order. It can help them with whatever needed. But it's a tough job out right now. And John, I think I'm going to let you take over some of these, some of the increases.
I think as we get ready to move into the Family Justice Center, it's probably important to take a look at. It seems to us that as the economy is going down, our numbers are going up. And I think probably Sam said that we're kind of like a business, but we're not, because generally, as the economy goes down, your business goes down too. But what we're experiencing is dramatic, and if you go to the next slide, dramatic increases in the number of folks who are needing services for domestic violence as the economy goes down. The other problem that we experience as a nonprofit is our funding sources are drying up at the same time we're having more and more people seeking services. So we're kind of in a difficult position. This year we have lost, just in our TANF funds, gone from $84,000 to $23,000. And that's, you know, when you set your budget last year, you budget for $84,000, and then all of a sudden you've got 23, and you all know you've got to figure out where to cut that. At the same time, you're having almost a doubling or a 50% increase in your services. It's hard to do. And what ends up happening is our folks are working twice as hard, and if there is any money to be squeezed out of it, it's coming out of personnel costs. And we can't operate in a field. I think we're looking very much forward to moving into the Family Justice Center, because that will alleviate some of our operational costs. I think the other thing that's important to look at, and Sam touched on it, is as a nonprofit, and we're working primarily on grant money and other funds of this kind, that we're bringing money into the county from other sources. We bring in $165,000 from the Governor's Crime Commission, emergency shelter grants, and other such things, and that's money that Family Abuse Services is bringing into the county. Paying employees who are working there, paying our employees. So the difficult position that we're in at this point, and I think Sam alluded to just thinking about it in the future, is our numbers are increasing in a dramatic fashion. Our funding is decreasing in a dramatic fashion. And as a result, we've got folks who are working twice as hard as they were before, and we're having to pay them less just to keep the doors open. So we appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Parker. High Impact Land Use Ordinance Appeal, Jason Martin, Planning Manager.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening.
Good evening.
I'll be very brief. You should have in your packets a memorandum from myself just kind of giving the background information of this appeal, as well as a copy of the appeal letter from Mr. Ed Peters and an aerial photo showing the surrounding area of the property. You see this is kind of right there on the Guilford County line. And also you should have a copy of the site plan that Mr. Peters submitted as required by the ordinance. It's just a rough drawing. The background on this: in December 2009, I received a phone call from a citizen that was concerned about the potential opening or reopening of a go-karting facility on Jug House Road. And I, at that time, I contacted Mr. John Larry Ford by telephone, who is the property owner, and he had informed me that Mr. Peters was leasing the property with the intent of constructing a commercial go-kart track. Mr. Peters did come by our office and meet with myself and Jessica Hill, our planner, to discuss the requirements of the High Impact Land Use Polluting Industries Ordinance. And after meeting with planning staff and inquiring about potentially grandfathering the facility, Mr. Peters filed an application for an intent to construct permit. And on December 22nd, I issued him a letter of denial for that permit. Just to kind of give you some information on the ordinance as well, there are two permits that are attached to the High Impact Land Use Polluting Industries Ordinance. First is an intent to construct permit, which is done before the construction is actually performed, expressing their intent to do so. And that covers the basic requirements. Does it meet the acreage requirement? Does it meet the spacing requirements? That sort of thing. And then there's an actual operational permit that is issued afterwards, before they can commence operations there. And if you think of it in terms of building permits, it'd be the equivalent of a certificate of occupancy. Mr. Peters did file an application for the intent to construct permit, and there are really three issues here as to why I denied the permit. The first I'd like to address is the issue of the grandfathering clause under the ordinance, and that is in Article 3, Section 1 of the High Impact Land Uses Polluting Industries Ordinance. A high impact land use or polluting industry that is existing and in operation upon the date of adoption of the ordinance, which would be the original date of adoption in August of 2006, would be considered a non-conforming use and would be grandfathered under the ordinance. It is the understanding of staff that the go-kart track has not been in operation for more than 10 years. And because of that, that is the reason why I denied based on grandfathering. The next issue is the issue of the minimum acreage required. And under the High Impact Land Use Ordinance, commercial racetracks are required to have at least a 40-acre minimum lot size, and that is under Article 2, Section 4G of the High Impact Land Use Polluting Industries Ordinance. The proposed site is approximately 19 acres according to the tax records. And then also the spacing requirement, the 2,000-foot spacing requirement from protected facilities, that is Article 2, Section 4E of the High Impact Land Use Polluting Industries Ordinance. And that specifies that all land uses regulated under the ordinance may not be located within 2,000 feet of a protected facility. And just to remind you all, protected facilities include child care centers, assisted living facilities, educational facilities, nursing homes, hospitals, rural medical centers, churches, and dwellings. And there are approximately 23 protected facilities located within a 2,000-foot spacing requirement. With that, that is all that I have. I'll be glad to answer any questions you all have at this time. And if not, I know Mr. Peters is here and would like to speak to the board. So.
All right. Questions, Mr. Martin?
What's on the other side of the county line?
Oh, okay. It's basically farmland. It's a lot of vacant land there. There are a few houses, and because of that, I did send a copy of this to Betty Garrett, the planning director in Guilford County, just so that they would have that information there for their citizens. But it's basically very similar to what you see on the other side.
All Does Jug House go all the way?
No, it stops at Gillum Church Road. It kind of has a T-bone intersection.
What's the distance, Jason, between the racetrack area potential and the county line?
I didn't scale it exactly, but I'd say between 100 to 150 feet.
That's close.
Give or take, yeah. It's very, very close.
Can you name some of the 22 protected?
Yeah, I was curious. That sounds like
quite a few churches and daycares and everything else.
They were, best I could tell, they were all dwellings. They were all houses.
So a house counts as that number?
It does.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
How many of those 23 signed the petition? Was it all?
There was
22 of them.
My understanding that Mr. Peters did take a petition out and received 22 signatures of the 23.
From those protected?
In support of. And I'll let Mr. Peters explain that a little bit more. But, yeah, the protected facilities, we took and got that information from the tax records, cross-referenced with GIS, based on whether or not there was an improvement of a dwelling, single-family home that, on the property. And the, or manufactured home.
Justin, did I read somewhere that we had to prove that those were? I was reading. Did I read that they had to maybe come in and sign something?
What you're referring to is the waiver portion of the spacing requirement, and that is in the ordinance. Let me flip to it.
Dwellings would have to come in, or the people.
They would
dwellings.
Have to come in.
Right.
That in,
it's on
it's in here.
Page 8 of the ordinance, Section F, spacing requirements for waiver. And that is if there are protected facilities within 2,000 feet, they can basically grant an easement to the property owner over their property.
So that's what he's saying he has, 22.
Well, he has put together a petition to do that. And just to explain the logic of staff on that is with there being 23 folks there to get a petition put together, the legal staff would have to put those easements together and it has to be approved by the county attorney.
Okay.
And so that's just a gauge to make sure there's serious support. Be. Right.
Okay. Yeah, because I knew I had read that today and I just wanted to find out about it. So they have actually not signed a waiver with Alamance County.
No, they have signed a petition though, expressing support.
Can you refresh my memory on the go-kart track that we approved up in, what was that, Pleasant Grove?
Yeah. That is a little bit different. That situation, the go-kart track was operating on the same property as their house, and it was a recreational facility that they were not going to operate for profit. Basically, the gentleman that did that was just setting it up for kids to play on. In the neighborhood, so that's the difference. There is this particular case; they are going to operate commercial and charge admission and set up concessions.
What similarities, if any, are there with buffers, acreage, and so forth?
The difference, and
the 20-some the protected.
Yeah, that's a good question. The one off of McRae Road, we actually ended up amending the ordinance at that time to exclude residential land use, and it was something that was implied under the ordinance that this ordinance would regulate commercial and industrial land use, but not residential, and that would consider that an accessory to their residence, basically, and that's it did not apply under this ordinance after the amendments were made.
Okay. And Mr. Peters is going to talk now.
Yes.
Okay. Hello.
Thank you for having me. Get my legs to quit shaking here. First of all, Jason said I was kind of in this by myself. I actually have a partner in this deal, Alan Lewis. He told me express he's sorry he couldn't be here. They had a death in his family. His girlfriend's father unexpectedly passed away on Saturday, and he couldn't be here. He's in West Virginia at the funeral right now. So I'm going to try to wing this thing by myself here. So I'm pretty nervous. So anyways, we're trying to put together the go-kart track again, which was on, and for several years run at the, you know, the Jug House Lake area. They had, for years, they had the, which most people in the county know, they had the Jug House Lake out there. Then they, the pool and the go-kart track was added, and it run for several, several years out there, which was run under, get out my notes here myself, it was Johnny Lee had run the go-kart track, and he's the one to put the swimming pool in, and it run it for several years. And then John Ford bought it and continued to run it, and to this day, there's still power on the premises. It's never cut power. Theoretically, he could keep rolling today. That's why I questioned the grandfathering on it. We went in there feeling this was going to be grandfathered. There was no issues. I mean, the place has been there for 60 years. He bought it as an amusement park. His business was listed Jug House Lake and Amusement Park. He bought it as an amusement park. So I put in my thing, if you buy an amusement park and one ride is broke, does that mean you don't have an amusement park no more? I run three businesses out of my shop. I run an automotive repair shop. I own a little race car business. We build race cars, and we have a machine shop. If I don't bore another motor or use the machinery in the next 4 years, that means I don't have a machine shop anymore. That's why I question why this isn't grandfathered. When Jason told me that, which Jason's been really good on this stuff, I said, look, I said, you know, I disagree with you. He says, well, you can appeal it. I says, all right. I says, I want to appeal it, but give us our next steps on this thing. I said, you know, we really want to make a family-oriented place for people to go. I'm a big family person. I worry about where the kids are going to go. I wonder what they're going to do. How can we protect them? How can we keep them off the streets with their goat carts, et cetera? So he said, well, he said, this is where the ordinance will fall. And he says, this is what you're going to have to do. Then all of a sudden he showed me these ordinances, and it's like blowing my mind here. It's like, you know, never knew when we started this thing there was so many ordinances over something like this. And it's like some of it just isn't logical and fit this situation. I mean, the whole go-kart track with the whole large area parking on here is only 7 acres. I mean, of course, got the lake and stuff over there, but feasibly what we're on, but yet they're asking for 40 acres there, which we can cover the 40 acres because my partner, Alan Lewis, his family owns 100 more acres behind the facility, so that's not an issue. But he said, well, he says, what you need to do is draw up some kind of petition, go and see within that 2,000 feet how the people in houses react. So Alan and myself, we drew up a petition, we took them to the homeowners, and we had, I believe there was 23, we had 22 out of the 23 sign it. Very supportive. I've got a copy I can give y'all right here. I tried to get as much stuff as I could here for you. Out of the 22, out of the 23, the only one that didn't sign it was Mrs. Hoard. And on this petition, we put right out there, we'll be running twice a month on Saturdays. If it's a 5 week month, we'll be running three times. There will be absolutely no alcohol on the premises whatsoever. There will be no Sunday racing whatsoever. All go-karts would be running mufflers. Noise was a concern. I didn't want to have any neighbors complain about it. We're really trying to do everything we can to keep this family. And even on here, when I took it around, I put on there, which I think you may have a copy, but I'm not sure, that we wanted to be, you know, courteous of the neighbors. I don't think you do, but I've got five of them here. I can give them to you here.
Is that the one that starts with topic one?
No, that's my kind of appeal. Here is the petition. That I had, that I got the 23 out of the 22 or 23, whatever. I lacked one, and that was Mrs. Hoard. And I went to all of them, explained that we're going to run mufflers and this and that. And the technology on the stuff has changed. They are quieter. You know, she said she's been out there for a long time. And I can appreciate people wanting to protect their property. I understand that. But we've had continuing support. We promised people that we wouldn't run late at night. We promised at the very latest we'd try to shut everything down at 10 o'clock. We would really prefer to run during the afternoons if we can do that. That would be our main goal, is trying to run a business, because if we don't have to turn the lights on, then we can save money also on top of that. And even on my track rules and regulations, I made up fighting. This is a family facility. Fighting will not be tolerated. Anyone involved will be removed from the premises and/or prosecuted by law. No drinking of alcohol. No drugs. No firearms. And then it goes in, and I don't let unauthorized motor vehicles out there, you know, the race vehicle, et cetera, et cetera. And I even put on here, I'm a family man, I'm a Christian. I even put cussing and swearing is prohibited. How you stop it all, I don't know, but darn if we ain't going to try. there's a lot of children.
After the wreck? After the wreck.
Yeah. But, you know, the go-karting is, you know, a lot of it's sanctioned. You know, you have these carters start out with the families at 5 years old. We have our little kiddie class that goes 5 to 8. Then it steps up. It's got to be family environment or you lose everything. You know, and then so we went and got that. And then there was a couple other issues. He said, we got looking down. He said, there's an issue of a fence. And I said, well, we're going to put a 4-foot surrounding fence all around the goat car, the staging area. We're fencing off where the spectators are going to park. And he said, well, according to this ordinance, it says you have to put a 6-foot high chain link fence up with barbed wire on top of it. And I says, I'm not being ugly, but when a kid hangs himself on a barbed wire, who's going to pay for it? I mean, some stuff in here just really, to me, just doesn't fit the situation right here. And then as far as the, I don't think people would have a problem coming in and signing anything, but I hope that we can grandfather this because I hate to be a burden on people. The economy's tight to make a person take off a day's worth of work to come in and sign a waiver for a go-kart track. That's like asking them to cut their wrist. I mean, me, myself, you know, I work hard. I've had a tough time keeping my help working right now because the economy's tight right now. Let's face it, the economy's tight. And, you know, our goal here is make a family environment where it's going to take us 12 to 15 people to put this thing in operation, which is jobs right now. When we got an 11-point unemployment rate, you know, they may not be the highest paying jobs in the world, but it's a job. That $50 might help somebody go to the grocery store. I mean, we're trying to do our part. You know, we're not going to put up with no nonsense. You know, I'm just committed to this. I mean, I just really want to put this deal together, and we want to abide by the law, but I want to abide by, and I ain't saying it's bad, a common sense law here. I just think when things were pointed out for a racetrack, I can understand if you got a half-mile asphalt oval track where you got to have mega parking. A go-kart is 1/4 the size of a full-fledged car. It just doesn't take that much operation. The actual track is 1/8 of a mile. The track itself is sitting on just a little over 2 acres itself. Then we have 3.5 acres worth of parking. It's a little dirt track.
Let me ask you something. Are you doing anything for the noise ordinance or for the noise problem?
We're running mufflers on the go-karts, which realistically cuts the noise in half. And I know she said there was an issue with...
Is it a requirement that they have to have mufflers?
Absolutely, and that's actually on our... It's on the website, which is under victorylaneraceway.net. It's specified. All carts will run mufflers, and even on our track rules, which we posted all over, it says right there, mufflers mandatory on all carts.
And you would pull them if they ran without
absolutely
one, is that correct?
And that was even on our petition, because I want to be courteous to the neighbors. You know, I said we've had a lot of support, but why make one upset with you? I would rather have them come to the racetrack. I mean, we're really doing everything we can to try to, you know, make this thing go and make it a family deal. Like I said, we had a driver's meeting Saturday at my shop, and I point blank told them out there, I says, it's not a matter of when it happens, it's who's got guts enough to test me on this, because it will be a family environment or we're going to just send them off. I mean, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it, because I know you had some issues with the McRae deal. This is, to me, this is a little bit different. And on top of that, it's like I have with me, we have a $1 million liability policy sitting on the racetrack grounds right now. And then once the carters take effect, they sign another paper, and there's another $1 million that covers the racers themselves being on it. We're not going to this with closed eyes. We're going to this to be professional. And I actually took a couple snapshots of it before I left today. They're not great pictures, but I took some pictures of the trees and stuff that are actually in front of it, because the whole front of the thing, and you can actually see on that little site survey there, the whole front of the property is covered with fully grown trees. These trees are probably 20 feet tall and right down the side too, and the full property is closed off.
Has the planning board recommended anything on this at all? I know you had a meeting.
No, ma'am, the planning board did not hear this. When there's a denial of a permit that's been applied to, those appeals are sent directly to the Forest Commission. So we're discussing.
Okay, here we go. I'm a little bit scattered here. But I actually took these today. They're not great pictures, but this is actually the front of the facility. You can pass them down. This is the left-hand side. The other part's got all the lake and everything else on. And this is the front. So the front of it's actually even gated so that people won't go in there.
Now, what is this first photograph?
That's the very front of the property with the trees.
Out near the road.
By the road.
I rode by there today.
Is this the...
Yeah.
That's it. Is this it right here? Yeah. All of this?
Mm-hmm. And you can see,
I've been there.
Right, and you can see the go kart track has been there for years and years.
Me too. Yeah, I've been there a lot of times.
And and that's it. It almost like the place ought to be on a historic site because it's been there for 60 years. Matter of fact, Mr. Lewis is here with me tonight. Alan's dad, that's my partner with this, and his their family's actually ones that built the place and built the original jug house. And I'm not asking for any special favors. I'm just asking that we can get something going here. I hope we can grandfather this thing. Personally, I feel it should be. The power's always been cut on, and within the last several years, they've run turkey shoots. They've run some sort of business out of there, and like I said, how do you separate the go-kart track when it's an amusement park? I just don't see how you can do that. That's me like taking one part of my business out of there. When I file my taxes, I file it all together. I don't file them separate.
Is Mr. Ford here tonight?
Mr. Ford is here with us tonight, too. Okay. And I hope we can grandfather this. I hope you consider that. I know things are tough when you do something like this, but we really do want to make this a nice place for people to come to. And as far as the garbage and stuff like that, there's no alcohol. There's not going to be bottles. We've really planned this thing out. We'll have somebody that will clean up afterwards. If I don't do it myself, it realistically is going to take 12 to 15 people to put this together. We will have sheriffs on the premises when we run the races and stuff. EMTs are on the premises when we do it. We're just not going into this closed-minded. We really want to do this right. As far as bathrooms, I know that come up. We're stuck using porta potties. I wish it could be better, but we're having a professional company bring them in. They're going to service them, and we're actually putting a little partition in between two of them and a little wall in front of them because my wife hates porta potties. She hates them with a passion, but she said, look, at least put a divider in a couple of them, put a little wall in front of them. She said, at least we open up the door, somebody ain't staring at us. But we're doing everything we can to make this thing right. So if you would, I wish you to please consider grandfathering this for us.
Anybody have any questions from Mr. Peters?
I've got one possibly back to Jason and the fact that it has been operating as an amusement park for these years.
Years.
Jerry, how long's that place been in operation? I was a kid. I went out there when I was a kid. So.
I don't know. Well, I'm 75 and my granddaddy built it.
Well,
before my time, really.
Well, being it was an amusement park, if they went in to say we're going to have go-kart rides, is that not part of an amusement park?
I would think the question to ask at this point is it going to be solely used as a go-kart track? If that's the case, then that is a pretty drastic change in the use of the property.
See, the concession stands where the lake is at in the pool, they can be fully operational now if they choose to go in there and do it. The power has never been cut off. If it was a dead place, nothing there, I may say you had something, but the power has never been cut off. The lights still burn out there.
How long ago was it that you bought it, Mr. Trump?
How long ago did you buy it, John? Did you tell me 10 years ago, 9 years ago?
From Johnny Lee, and it was operating then. Is that not correct?
Yep. And, they was going to keep it going, and cost just started skyrocketing, but they have had ongoing things. They've had turkey shoots and stuff like that out there.
So there has been operation.
There has been some kind of things going out there. That's why I said, how do you pinpoint one thing when it's been listed as amusement park?
And tax-wise, you've been taxed as a
commercial venue. Yep. Still paying commercial property tax.
Makes it a little difficult.
By a show of hands, how many people that signed this petition are here tonight? Can you raise your hand?
No.
Just three? Okay.
I didn't know if we should ask people to come, or I would ask for more support to come. But like I said, I figured we had to support with the petition itself. We went individually, me and Alan, myself, we went to each house, explained what we was doing. And other than people asking us about what about the noise, we assured them about the mufflers. That seemed to be the only resistance we really had on it was the noise issue on it.
Right.
And like I said, the technology has changed. I mean, with the mufflers and stuff, they're half as noisy as normal.
And the issue is our ordinance, where, the grandfather says it must be run in. That's the issue, basically. And you can get the 40 acres.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have one person that didn't sign. So there's the two issues that we would have to do a variance. Is that not right, Justin?
And then as far as...
We'd have to have a variance for that.
If we go that route, are you going to make us put up a 6-foot-high fence with barbed wire?
All right. The two issues are that it's not grandfathered. That's one issue. The other issue is that we don't have 100% signatures. So we would have to vote for a variance on that. Or would we have to change the ordinance? I mean, that's my question.
I don't know.
Because it's already in operation.
Yeah, I think as the place has been in business for 40 years or 100 years, continuously, I don't see that we need to change the variance.
It's a matter of reclassifying something.
I have a suggestion. He's advertised it as a racetrack, not an amusement park, all over the internet. He's had driver's meetings, and that's fine. And he's already testified before tonight that he can get the 40 acres.
Right.
So why not just move the track 2,000 feet from the objecting property owner, get the petitions from the other 23, and move on?
Well, the one of the reasons is, I hate to butt in, I hope that's okay, is with the ordinance, they want to put up a 6-foot-high fence around the track with barbed wire on top of it.
The reason that that's there is to keep people from coming and using it when you're not there.
But the facility's gated.
Right, but you can go around the gate. You can't just put a gate over a driveway.
The whole facility is fenced in.
And then, see, we're going to put a 4-foot-high fence around the track itself, which is typical with most racetracks.
But I think your ordinance works. And the reason it's built this way and the reason it's set up this way is to prevent things like that. Because we're not a rural county like we were 70 years ago. With farmland and, a mile between your neighbor's house. So if the man can get the land, and he get that distance between Ms. Horn, is that the lady that objected?
We can't just up and move the racetrack. I mean, you're dealing with several things to move a racetrack. I'm not being ugly because I don't know how much you know about race, but these racetracks cure and make the dirt racing. I mean, these people come from all over, like Liberty, wherever they go, because they've all got their unique surface that's been packed for years and years. It's tough to build a track and make it get where it is today. I mean, the surface on that track is awesome. I mean, I've had guys, when they heard we was going to do this, they just like said, man, I won a darn championship there, and just let me know when you're going. And, I feel it's been in operation, so I just don't understand why we can't grandfather it, or if we can get it grandfathered. I mean, I'm hoping and praying we can.
Are you guaranteeing one day a week?
I'll guarantee it. Racing one day. Now, we had up in the air about a practice for 2 hours on possibly a Wednesday night, but that's, I'm still dealing with my insurance company on that, because we will not have any events that I can't cover under insurance, because I own a business. I can't afford to have somebody come back and sue me for not having something there. I will not run it. I've got the paper right here. I will not run something that is not 100% covered. I just can't do that.
So the reason I asked that, you did say just Saturday.
Right. Yeah, we will not race no other day other than Saturday.
We'll be through at 10 o'clock.
We'll be done by 10 o'clock. Like I said, we really truthfully want to be done during the afternoon hours if we can. We're looking at hopefully starting this thing about 12, 1 o'clock. Barn rain delays or whatever, I would really like to be done by 7, 8 o'clock at night. You know, I've been through some issues. I've been at racetracks since I was knee-high to a grasshopper, and I've seen people waste time, and I just feel we can do better than that with the way we're doing things. And when you got children out there that's 5 to 8 years old in a kiddie class, you can't keep them there till midnight. And I just, you know, I've seen other tracks do that, and it's just not right. It's not right to the families. And I refuse to do that.
Yeah, I know we can't please everybody. That's what our government's based on, majority rule and so forth and so on. You know, I think we need to be honest. We created this ordinance for something bigger than stuff like this.
Right.
And you know, all I've seen since the ordinance, I'm not saying we need to cancel the ordinance, but I know I sat here when I approved it. I said, can we say no? Can we reject it? Can we overrule? And so forth. And the answer back then was yes. But I haven't seen anything but, you know, picky Mickey Mouse issues brought up through this ordinance deal versus the big things that I thought it was created for. Real hazards. And so, you know, what's impressing me is the signatures. And, you know, I support what he wants.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Peters, I'm really confused on all of this.
Okay,
you start off on your appeal talking about this wonderful family place.
Yes, ma'am. That, and the first part of it was for the grandfathering. Yeah. You know, I had to kind of do the appeal in two part. If we couldn't get the grandfather, then about the restrictions as far as the fencing and stuff like that.
Okay. Then did you personally go out and get these signatures? Because I had some phone calls yesterday, and the gentleman was quite upset because he did not have the opportunity to sign it or to turn it
down. Yes, ma'am. I went to every one of them. I was part of every one of them that went out.
Well, I hope he shows up tonight. He said,
I hope he does too, because I promise you.
And it was supposed to be, I'm not trying to be argumentative.
Sure.
Honest. It's supposed to be signatures from homeowners. And he said that Ms. Wade, the Wade family, was not there, and someone that was staying at that house.
According to the ordinance, that was and or people that have a lease on the property as far as renters and stuff.
Okay, I'm not familiar with that. Mm-hmm. Now, 6-foot-high chain link fence
with
barbed wire seems to me would keep somebody out. As a kid, I can tell you a 4-foot chain link fence would not have kept me out of anywhere I wanted to go.
Can you throw a
go-kart over that? The 6-foot. Neither will the 6-foot if it won't end.
But.
And that's what you were concerned about, to keep the kids out. A 4-foot fence is not going to keep kids out.
But
we will see that as a challenging go.
Yeah, but they've
got to have their carts coming with them. They're not going to leave the carts.
Yeah, no, we'll be there all the time. And the actual property itself has got a fence around it. I hate to look at this thing as a prison. I mean, somebody coming to the racetrack, standing at the racetrack, 6 foot high with barbed wire going over top. That's like the prison right there. I mean, 4 foot high, people's got to look and watch the racing. The, you know, fences are made to keep kids from running in there. They're meant to keep people out. But yet you still got to watch the operation that you're doing. They want to see their carts going around. They want to see the children going around out there.
Okay.
And this absolutely will end at 10 o'clock at night, although you have some elderly folks live out there.
Ma'am, I'll tell you, my wife has kicked up so much dirt about coming home late from racetracks. That was one of the deals when I told her I was involved in this thing.
Do I hear I'll entertain a motion?
I'll make the motion that we accept the grandfather for this session.
Can I please speak? Yes, ma'am.
One thing, he has presented you guys with a lot of lies. That lake has not been in operation for over 10 years since Johnny Lee sold it to this gentleman. It opened maybe about a month out of the year. It's grown up. There's old trailers on it. There's old abandoned cars. The racetrack itself was grown up until last week, and they went down there with bulldozers and cleared it up. It has not been in operation for the last 10 years.
We know that.
There has not been a car on that track in 10 years because it grew up. And then they got the issues of the lake down there. That lake is spring fed, and if there's a contamination into it, I know it will affect my well. Because Johnny Lee, when he owned it, busted one in the spring, and I got muddy water. So who's to say that it won't get contamination? And what's going to keep the kids out from the lake over there? There's already been several drownings in that lake. And that's why Johnny Lee had to close. So I wish you'd really take it into consideration. And plus, the other 20-some households, they're all kin to the leases. No. Thank you.
As far as any kind of chemicals with the carts, these carts don't hold the equivalent of gasoline that a big car does. They don't hold the equivalent of a big car in oil. 90% of these goat carts hold less than one quart. If anybody pulls any oil out of these things, we have disposable oil drums on the premises. It'll be there that have seals on them, and it will be hauled off whenever the time comes in. There will not be no running oil off. I mean, I have a race car shop. I've been in racing all my life, and there's just, you know, we will do everything we can to protect everything on this thing. I promise you that. And as far as the lake goes, there is a fence that separates the track from going over there. I'm not going to stand up here and say you could keep everybody out of there. How could you keep them out of there as it sits right now? I can't. I mean, you just can't.
So you don't operate the lake as well?
No,
during the summer?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. You know, John and them, they've talked about doing some things, but that's up to them. You know, I have my hands full just trying to do this because I want to keep this professional. I don't want to riffraff. I mean, I want to make a place for people to come with their kids.
So it's not going to be an amusement park. It's just going to be a go-kart track.
It can be an amusement park. I mean, they've talked about possibly down the road doing something with it again. I mean, one of the reasons why they basically quit the pool was because they kept having liner problems. They've talked about looking back at doing it again. And right now it's listed as amusement park. The power's on this amusement park. Everything.
I have a motion on the floor.
Second.
And a second on the floor. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No.
Thank you so much.
The next thing on our agenda is Sheriff Johnson, the reorganization of the County Sheriff's Office. Hold on. Okay. You got fingers.
Commissioner, before I get started, I would like to inform you that we just received word that David Leonard's father-in-law just passed away, Mr. Dennis Doss. He was a big supporter of all law enforcement in this county. So I wish you keep his family in your prayers. Where is the... What I'd like to do is, you know, I've heard Mr. Sutton talk about performance-based management, and that's what we're doing a little of here, I think. I hope so. Anyway, what I'm appearing for you tonight to show you and talk to you about the reorganization of the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. A little over, it was around the 1st of November, I met with our county manager, explained to him that we were having some retirements in the Alamance County Sheriff's Department, some of them high positions, and based on the increase for calls for service, and even domestic violence and juvenile problems in the homes, that we needed to try to put more people on the street and in the investigation ends where our increase was coming. And certainly domestic violence was one of those along with juvenile. And so with that in mind, I would like to go over it. Position reclassification by the request. With an ever-increasing demand for public safety service increase, violent crime rate, it has become necessary to find innovative ways to get more officers on the street. With the lean economic times, I am compelled to find within my current budget a solution to answer those demands. With current and upcoming retirements, I was able to reassess my current staffing levels, and that was very important. I could not, until these individuals reached close to retirement, that had the high salaries, could not run them off with 20, and would not, because they served their purpose with the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. When we first went in office, we had a young department, and we need all the experience we could get that was willing to step up to the plate and foster that burden. So with that, we looked at reclassifying some of these positions once the retirements come. Some have come, some will be here by April 1st. It says, therefore, I request the board consider the following. I would like to reclassify four administrative positions to deputies and assign them to the patrol division, which would add one officer to each platoon. Now, what would this do? This will certainly cut down on our response time to citizens that need our services. It will certainly also enhance the visibility of our patrol vehicles on the streets, hopefully with the increase in burglaries and larcenies, that more patrol being seen would certainly deter some of the criminal activity that we're encountering at this time. And it says this classification would also create a net savings of $94,371. Okay, with that, and I'll explain this to you. You see the detention, that is Captain Brad Evans, who is retiring. His salary and current cost, and I want you to understand now, this includes all the benefits. So don't think a captain down there kind of sheriff's department makes $66,000 because they don't. This is with the entire benefit package. Okay, if we take his position, we turn that into a regular deputy position at $42,613. That's benefit packages and everything from Deputy One. Savings in that position will be $23,826. Same thing with Cab Patrol. Gary Summers is retiring. Gary's been with the Alamance County Sheriff's Office several years, and both of these individuals have done outstanding jobs, I'm telling you, with what's put on. But his salary, $70,179. His position got down to a Deputy One, savings of $27,256. Lieutenant, that was Lieutenant Over Vice, which we have not filled. We held it until we could do this reclassification. You see his current cost, and then what our Deputy One would be a savings of $22,667. With Corporal, who's been with us a while, retiring, and that savings would be $20,312. Okay, what I'd like to do with some of that savings, not all of it, is create two more positions with that saving. And these two new positions are the cost savings from the reclassification. One position would be assigned to the juvenile division, which is domestic violence and juvenile. What we're finding is when you have domestic violence in the home, you normally have juvenile problems. Kids with problems at school, acting out. We assign one person to that division as an investigator. One position will be reassigned to the Vice Narcotic Division. The reason for this is the amount of narcotics coming up and down our streets, coming into our county, and we're collecting so much overtime for our Vice Division and some of our gang unit members that we've got to do something, because we can't, when you have to give them time and half pay, which the county don't do, or time and half off, guess what? You lose their services when you need them. And so we're going to add one to that division. Okay, total cost of these two positions will be $85,226. And then we would like to reclassify two positions to the rank of sergeant to help offset some of the administrative stuff that we're going to be hurting with by taking these two people out, the desk sergeant and the computer forensic internet crimes against children. At a cost of, it would be an additional cost of $4,548, which in turn, this would create a total of six positions from the four current administrative positions. Two positions would be reclassified to sergeant. Cost, total cost was $89,774. The current cost without these reclassifications is $94,371. Are there any questions? Okay.
Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
How many patrol people would that put on the street?
That put four additional, one on each shift. Right now, we have a total of nine on each platoon, and that would add one to each platoon, which a lot of times, especially in domestic violence calls, we have to send two, sometimes three vehicles, and then other calls come in, and we have to break somebody loose in response time, say it's domestic violence and mebbing. then that individual has to come over because maybe another officer's tied up on a call all the way from Snow Camp. Well, by the time another vehicle gets back to Snow Camp, you're looking at 30, 35 minutes.
Are these officers BLET certified?
Every one of them will be BLET certified.
Will be.
Yeah, some already are. We got what we do, we hire people, good example, we hire people and put them in the jails BLET certified until a position opens up.
Right.
They work the detention division. And all these people are coming out, four people coming out of detention division right now that we're talking about.
Three. So what's going to happen in detention?
We have to replace those people. We have to hire people to put them in detention division, and we have a waiting list.
Are they on the budget? Do you have a
These positions in detention, when I take a man out of detention and put him in one of those positions, that position is still open in detention. Right. We hire a new hiree going in there, and it's something we haven't figured, but they usually start a less salary because this guy's got experience going out, there may be more safe.
Okay, but everything's already in the budget. That's
oh, yes, ma'am. Matter of fact, that man looked at me in that office there. He said, "Sheriff, you can do what you want to, but you better not go over your budget." I said, "Mr. Honeycutt, I promise we won't go over the budget." So, anyway, this is what we're proposing. And with the increasing costs that we're finding and the more complex investigations Alamance County Sheriff's Office is finding himself into right now, we've got to do something in order to ensure the citizens of this county that we're going to give them ample protection.
Are we any closer? I know it's maybe you're not concerned with relative to what you're talking about here, but are we any closer to getting some satellite stations for our sheriff's department?
Yes, sir. We have satellite stations. Already have them. The thing is that the officers, because they're answering calls, don't always get to.
Where are they?
Okay, we've got one in Village of Alamance. We have one in Saxby Hall. We have one in Altam Hall, Ossipee. We have one
at the fire department.
Yes, sir. Okay. They're at the fire department. Of course, Green Level pays for one. And then you've got your Snow Camp substation that the Snow Camp group gave to the county.
Good. Okay.
But the thing is, these officers, what they do, they can meet some of the victims of the crimes there to take reports versus them having to come into Graham and take a report. And also, when we have shift change, used to everybody come to Graham, sat in there and had their meeting, exchange their stuff. Meantime, calls were coming in out in the field. What we do, they change their papers with the car coming on. If they have warrants or they have problems, they get briefed on what's taking place in their district. And they don't have to come to Graham to be respond back. And so that's cut some gas, time, everything, those districts.
I should have known that, but I didn't. So.
It's good. I'm glad you asked.
At least I'm honest.
Yes, you are.
Can I go back? You have, I believe, four ICE people in the detention center?
No, there's more than four trained, but we have four that are working in the detention center.
Sheriff, how does that contract read? Are they under the control of ICE? Mm-hmm. Or are they under control of Alamance County?
They're under control of Alamance County Sheriff, but the sheriff is under control of ICE in that there's rules and regulations that I have to follow as the top administrator of Alamance County Sheriff's Department, and I have to ensure that my people follow their rules and regulations, and we're doing that.
Do we have a copy of that contract?
I think we did. The memorandum of agreement.
Well,
yeah.
Officers.
Yeah.
Officers.
Mm-hmm. I gave one because you helped get it saved.
That's right.
Do we need a motion on this?
Yeah, it's more for information.
Okay.
I want to advise y'all what we're trying to do.
He's just giving us the courtesy. The county commissioners don't have any say so in how he runs his operation. He is giving us the courtesy by doing this.
But I want you to understand. I want the blessings of the county commissioners if I can get it.
I think you have our blessings.
Some people don't bother to understand.
Right.
I think you have our blessings. Okay.
We understand. We just have questions.
No. Hey.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Are we going to take number 8 off, Craig?
You're
going to do that? Okay.
I've got to get home in time to see this Massachusetts race now.
Me too.
It's a race off.
Me too. Get Obama out of office and this throwaway money.
Thank you.
Polls closed today.
Are you going to read this whole thing?
They know now.
Explain it five words or less.
I need to recess. My coal's fixing to come out.
Evening, Commissioners. Obviously, Sheriff Johnson, I'm filling in for David tonight. Y'all, if you can just keep him in your prayers, his family, because it's been a tough go for him. Basically, what I want to do is try to give you a brief rundown on the hazardous mitigation plan here in Alamance County. Back in June of 2001, the General Assembly passed the Senate Bill 300, and part of that was, and that plan was that every county in North Carolina would have a hazardous mitigation plan in order to qualify for certain funds and funding and grants in case of disaster, whether that's a state disaster or a presidentially declared disaster. Alamance County, of course, our plan is in place, thanks to Mr. Jerry Beckham. Everybody remembers Jerry. Jerry and the fire marshal's office, they laid the groundwork. They did the plan. They got the first one enacted in 2005. The state says, basically in a nutshell, that every 5 years we will review the plan annually in our office, and we do that. And every 5 years we will update the plan. Well, Alamance County, our time is up. September of this year is when our plan is to be submitted and approved to the state. I will iterate to you guys that talking with the people in Raleigh from emergency management, they have stressed to us, Alamance County has a workable, viable plan. It's a good plan. And their words to us was, when you guys work on this thing, don't reinvent the wheel. So the plan is in effect as we speak. So since last summer, we've been working on it in the office, trying to update the plan, places in it where we need it to, due to maybe population or whatever, need to go in and do some update on it. The biggest thing, I think, in the plan this year, and the state really pushed this through North Carolina Emergency Management, was if the counties could, to get all the municipalities to join into one plan. In other words, we had the Alamance County plan, and I've got a copy of it here. The city of Burlington had their own plan. The city of Graham had theirs. And if you recall, I think back in August, y'all approved for Graham to come on board. They have gotten a letter back from FEMA saying, you know, giving them their blessings on it. So Graham is coming on board on Alamance County's. I got word yesterday afternoon that the city of Burlington is going to come on board with the county plan. In our office, we should be receiving a letter from the city of Burlington probably in the next week or two. The biggest thing that this thing affects, and I've got it here, is basically the four main ones is the HMGP grant, the Hazardous Mitigation Grant Program, the PDM, the Pre-Disaster Mitigation, the Severe Repetitive Loss, and the Flood Mitigation Assistance. They're the main four ones that we would be affected by. We do get these grant monies, like the HMGP. We get that pretty much every year here in the county. And to give you kind of a guideline what this thing is working on, like I said, back the 1st of December, we sent all the municipalities a copy of this for them to review, and we asked them to get back with our office by the 1st of the year with anything that they felt like they needed in it. And we did hear back from a few of them. They came back with a few suggestions and stuff, and we took it and, you know, changed it, put it in, and so forth. State says we got to have two meetings, this being one of them, for any kind of public input or comments on it. What we're shooting to do is go about the end of February and go ahead and get it to the state for them to review it and look at it. And they may have some tweaking on it to do. I'm honestly kind of expecting probably some things on it, you know. I mean, it kind of goes with the territory. But we're expecting to hear back from them, and if there is anything that we need to do in it, get that finalized and get it back to the state for the final approval by September. That's kind of it in a nutshell, in it, really. Like I said, the two good things was that Graham's coming on board in Burlington. You know, do they have to? No, they don't have to. But the state really pushes that. to try to get all the municipalities, and with Graham and Burlington coming on, we will have everybody in Alamance County, every municipality.
So we got to September to read this.
Well, sure.
Oh, yes, let me read it.
But no, really, that's pretty much the rough draft.
I've heard about it anyway.
And
I sure have.
Hopefully, you know, hopefully, Lord willing, we'll never have to use this thing. But hey, look what happened in Haiti last week.
Yeah, you
know, we have a major hurricane come through Alamance County, a tornado, whatever. You know, one thing that we did spend a lot of time was going back from 05 up till now, going back in and updating all the storms. If you go through there, you'll find every storm that we've had, because we had to go in and pull every one of them, whether it was a high wind storm, a lightning storm, a tornado, or whatever, ice storm. You know, we had to go in and put it in. So, like I said, a lot of it is we didn't reinvent the wheel on it. The plan is in place. It's just updating it. And like I said, if something major came down, say in 2011, we had some kind of disaster here in the county, at that time, we can pull it back out and say, oh, we've got to update something. And we can go back in and update it. So that's kind of where we stand with it.
How protected are our water supplies in our county?
I think that they're fairly protected. I've been out on calls with this where I've gotten calls where people have gone out and dumped over a 55-gallon drum, and you've always got these scragglers out here that they're going to do something. They're going to go out here and dump out stuff. Unless you got something like we had years ago, you know, where they had the trucks running up and down the road dumping stuff in the county. I mean, we're going to probably always have to deal with isolated cases like that. But to answer your question, I would say they're fairly protected. I know the city of Burlington, in fact, we met out at Lake Camac last year, and the guy over in Burlington is head of the emergency management. He's working on a grant right now to tighten up security at Lake Camac. They're supposed to be getting, I think, around $180,000 for tighter security out at Lake Camac, because it's remote, it's out in the middle of nowhere, and it would be easy for somebody to walk up and mess with the dam out there or whatever they wanted to do, you know.
See, over in Greensboro, I approached a water facility in Greensboro just to ask a question, and I looked real dangerous. I got out of a driver's ed car, and I had two kids in the car, and he went for his gun. And I said, calm down, I just want to ask a question about your facility here. And he said security was awfully tight.
Right.
This was after 911, to be honest about it, about right. A year after that. He said they were really on.
And I did go down to the South Burlington Waste Treatment Plant last week to do a fire inspection. And they're on their game down there.
Good.
I mean, it's pretty tight.
Do you know anything about the Mebane water supply? Mm. I know they've had some problems with it.
No, ma'am, other than they do report to our office as far as Tier 2 reporting, as far as what kind of chemicals that they store there on the facility. And I do have that. I do have access to pull that up in my vehicle if we were to respond out there to it. I do have the access to be able to pull that up and see what they've got on site and what they use, which I have that pretty much 98% of the businesses here in Alamance County. If I get a call at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, I should be able to access and pull up what they're using, how much they've got there, what's spilled, how much is spilled, and I can print it off and hand it to the fire chief.
So. Any more questions?
Just one. Now, you'll bring this back in February, you said?
Yes, sir.
And we'll have a public hearing on that?
We'll have another meeting, yes, sir. That is correct.
At that time, we'll approve or disapprove or whatever.
Right. It's more or less, I guess, to get y'all's blessings on it. Yeah. And what we'll do at that point, we'll send it on to the state.
Okay.
And they'll review it and whatever they do. I mean, like I said a while ago, honestly, I suspect that they'll probably have one or two things that they will say, have you looked at this, or have you tweaked this, or I don't know, have you addressed terrorism? You know, I'm kind of expecting a little something, but my argument to them is, well, you approved it in 05 and it worked then, you know. So, I mean, we do have a good workable plan, so.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, next on our agenda is Recreation and Parks Grants. Brian Haygood, Recreation and Parks Director.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening to request your approval. Our department's preparing to apply for three different recreational grants. I've put a memo in your package for you to read, and I'll just briefly touch on each of these three grants. And if you have any questions at the end, I'll be happy to answer them, and then hopefully you'll approve our application. First grant we plan to apply for is a North Carolina Recreational Trails Program. We're going to apply for $75,000 from the state to install some trailside amenities at several of our paddle accesses around the county. This grant does require a 25% match. However, we've been really successful in acquiring these. We're able to use a lot of in-kind, our own staff doing work, using equipment that we have, and we usually try to budget some in operating to cover anything that we can't do with in-kind. So this has been a fairly successful grant for us in the past 2 years. Also, we're preparing to apply for the North Carolina Adopt-a-Trail Program. This will be to acquire an amount of $5,000 to do a lot of trail work, particularly along the Challenge Golf Course that has recently been donated to the county. So we're getting ready to start developing that piece of property, and we need a little bit of assistance to get that underway. And the final grant that we're preparing to apply for, all of these are due 1st of February. Last one is the big one. This is we're going to submit a grant for PARTIF, Parks and Recreation Trust Fund, in the amount of $340,000. And what we hope to be able to do is down at Cedar Rock Park, leverage the funds that the county is preparing to allocate for the second round facility improvement, to do two projects in particular that did not make facility improvement plan list. One was the work to the Garrett House Kitchen, which was removed early on in the facility improvement plan process, and also after our master plan had recommended the construction of an enclosed shelter there at Cedar Rock Park. We have numerous open shelters, but there's a desire to have something that would be closed in for classes or family gatherings. Again, that wasn't applicable facility improvement plan. We plan to use those funds to try to leverage some money from the state to build both of those. We've actually had one advertised public meeting. Part of this grant has been before the Parks Commission. They have recommended that it be approved by you as well. We've had one civic group meeting and are planning the second one, which is all part of that process. So, all of these grants require a blessing from the County Board of Commissioners. So at this time, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer. If not, if you approve them, that would be wonderful too.
You have any questions? You might.
Is there any way that we can, instead of putting our 25% to those Port-a-Johns, that we can come up with something besides, rather than putting funds in there, to come up with something that's going to cost us to do anyway, that'll match for that amount of money?
We've applied for three of these over the past couple of years and been very successful getting them. And the primary amount of our match is in-kind labor by the department staff. So we put a dollar amount on. If our guys go out there with trucks, tractor, do site work.
That's what I was asking.
Okay.
Right.
That answers my question.
Yeah. We try very hard to use the in-kind labor. There are formulas out there right now to put a dollar amount on that work that we can use with the state. That's primarily how we make the match. Anything else, we're taking from our operating budget, and it's usually pretty small amount of money because we're taking it from operating. We would much rather claim that work.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
So
we
moved.
I have a motion. Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Finance matters, budget amendment number 74, schools capital project.
This budget amendment is for the schools capital projects, and it is to add $2,261,582 for the Career Tech Center, and this is state lottery proceeds. There's no county funds involved in this, and this is for the purchase of the land and for the design phase of the construction.
Any questions?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
You mean for how much money?
$2,261,582. The land purchase is actually, I think, $1 million.
I thought it was less than a million.
Yeah, I think the land and the site improvements, I think there had to be some demolition as well. So all that number would have to be around $1 million.
Mm-hmm. The design, that's going to cost over $1 million.
Well, I think part of it is going ahead and moving their requirement from the lottery, you know, their cash requirement from the lottery, just going ahead and moving it all at one time.
But I'm asking, is it going to cost $1 million to design it?
No, sir. I think they're going ahead and moving what they need to as far as the match. Once we do the QSCAB bonds, So I think they just went ahead instead of moving it once, moving it all at one time.
Do we know how much it's going to cost to design?
The design, I think bids are supposed to come back in the next couple of weeks on that, so we don't have a final cost on that yet. The total, I think, they're looking at $7.5 million. So it's about $5 million we're looking for the QSCAB. So this is their match of $2.5 million of capital.
So they're just wanting to get this from the state lottery funds to put towards the overall project.
Right.
If I'm understanding.
Right.
Any more questions? I entertain a motion to approve this budget amendment.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Opposed?
Okay. That's that one. Next is a budget amendment from number 77 from the Health Department. Hello, how are you? Good.
Good evening to everyone. Barry Bass is at a pre-scheduled Board of Health, personal health meeting and could not be here. Yeah, exactly. So I will go over our request with you this evening. We have received $1,935 from the March of Dimes to support the Centering Pregnancy Program for the Health Department. As you may know, the mission of the March of Dimes is to improve the health of babies by preventing birth defects, premature births, and also infant mortality to help reduce that. Centering Pregnancy is a nationally recognized best practice, and it gives pregnant women and their partners information about medical and lifestyle issues related to a healthy pregnancy and how to have healthy pregnancy outcomes. The prenatal visits or sessions are held in groups at the health department, and it allows the moms to bond with each other and also to exchange maternity experiences. So the funds that we've received will be used for supplies and materials needed to support the program. And so we're asking for your approval of this amendment request.
Any questions?
I'll make a motion that we...
I have a motion on the floor. No second. All in favor?
Aye.
No touch. All right. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Next is the county manager reports to set a public hearing for facilities improvement plan Group B projects.
All right. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. With respect to our Group B projects, we need to schedule a public hearing to look at the financing method at our February 1 commissioners meeting. The mode of financing that we're looking at this time is either Build America bonds or Recovery Zone bonds, and these are both part of the stimulus package. Right now, we're trying to get a reallocation for the Recovery Zone. If we can't get the full reallocation of what we need, we're going to do all Build America bonds. So we're waiting to see about that allocation. Bid opening on Group B projects will be this week on Thursday. And I'll let you know the results as soon as I do. But we do need to set the public hearing for the financing.
Do I hear a motion that we set the public hearing?
Make a motion we set the public hearing.
Second. A motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed?
If possible, and I talked to the chairwoman before the meeting, we do need to set another public hearing. And this goes back to the QSCAB and the Career Tech Center. We're getting close. Bids should be in the next couple of weeks on that. Do you know the date that's supposed to be in?
No.
I think it's in the next couple of weeks, but it is gone out to bid. But we should have that information in by February 1. We also need to set that public hearing for those bonds as well on February 1.
Would you like your motion for that?
I'll make that motion.
Have a motion second. That we set public hearing in a second. All in favor? Okay.
Next is the county line issue. And on Friday afternoon, I met with Orange County Manager Frank Clifton to discuss where we're at and basically where we agreed upon a process and where we disagreed upon a process. In all honesty, there's more things that we agree upon than we disagree. And we are working together jointly to come up with a memo to give to both boards to give clear direction. I think there's been some miscommunication on both ends where we've taken things out of context that, you know, well, I thought they were going to do this, well, I thought you meant this. So that's why we sat down together on Friday. We are working on that memo, and hopefully I'll get his comments back tomorrow that I'll be able to give to the board and kind of give you a clearer direction of where we agree, at least upon staff level, about the next direction for the county line issue. So if there's any questions about that.
I don't have any questions. Am I going to? Okay. Thank you for that, and we look forward to hearing from you on that. Okay. The next is the consent agenda. Does anybody want to pull anything off of that? If not, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda? Have a motion on?
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. At this time,
since I found my paper.
Oops. I just had it here. I don't know what I got. At this time, I move we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143.318.11A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of initial employment of an individual. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
I'll read it again.
Second.
All in favor?
All in favor, say aye.
Your voice is getting so hoarse.
I know it was getting.